wake up and count my blessings. No more worries, no more stressing. With every loss, there comes a lesson. Lord, all I'm asking is protection. I wake up and count my blessings.
Greetings, massive. Translation. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Conversations with Me, a Random Knowbody. Now, today's conversation is going to be with Mr. Troy Browne. Troy and I actually work together, and we've known each other for a few years now. I wanted to have this conversation with Troy today because he recently participated in a fitness challenge. And I know you're wondering, fitness challenge, who doesn't participate in those? Well, this one was actually a little bit more because it not only challenged him physically, it also challenged him mentally. And we all know that, you know, it's pretty not easy, but it's doable to participate in certain challenges for, say, you know, 14, 21 or 28 days, but 75 days is a lot. And I thought that it would be cool to have Troy on the podcast to actually talk about how this whole challenge impacted his life, because it's something to commit to eating a certain way for a certain amount of time, but to do the other things that the challenge required, I really wanted to see, you know, how he went about making sure he got it done for those 75 days straight. So here's our conversation. I hope you enjoy it. I appreciate you for being here. Thank you for subscribing. If you haven't subscribed to the podcast, please, wherever you're listening to it, just hit that subscribe button, the follow button. And, you know, write me a review if you're listening to it and you're like, oh, this is cool, or oh, this is whack. Let me know what you think. I really do want to know. I'm not scared of criticism, guys. So reach out and, you know, let me know what you think. So without further ado, here's my conversation with Mr. Troy Browne. And he wears a lot of hats, which we'll get into, you know, in this episode. So I'm not going to spill it all here. Enjoy, guys. Mr. Troy Browne, welcome to Conversations with Me, a Random Knowbody.
Thank you for having me.
Absolutely. So today's conversation is going to be centered around, you know, the ability to get things done and to do hard things. But before we start with that, I did want to ask a question about this legendary week you had about 7 years ago. You know, I just want to know. I just want to know.
So if you don't know me, I have this love for Cinnabons.
Okay.
And let me clarify, I mean like the brand name Cinnabons, not like a cinnamon roll from the grocery store or Panera Bread. It has to be a Cinnabon from Cinnabon. So there was a week in college that all of the stars lined up where I had about, so there are 6 packs of Cinnabons and each Cinnabon has over 800 calories. And so I had 16 Cinnabons in about 8 days. Because what happened was I bought myself a box, then someone else bought me a box. And then that weekend I had a race and my mom and dad came and they surprised me with a box. And I'm just like, you know what? I'm just going to indulge myself.
Oh my God.
But you know what? I felt every single Cinnabon in my stomach that first hard workout and it did not look pretty.
So did you have any other food and you're saying Cinnabon and I say Cinnabon. So I'm assuming that's the correct way to say it, because you're not just going to say it any way.
No. And some of my friends will tell you that we have gotten into arguments about Cinnabon versus cinnamon rolls, the brand name, the non-brand name, and like mini bonds versus Cinnabons. Like one time I was in London, I was studying abroad, and there was a London Cinnabon, and I end up having a 40-minute conversation with the manager, and he offers me a job on the spot because he's like, do you work at a Cinnabon? Why do you know these? I just love the product. And it was funny because that Cinnabon had the exclusive Choco Bon, which I have never seen before in my life.
So when people say, oh, you know, like you said, there's this new place opening up and they have these Cinnabons or whatever, you're like, if it's not Cinnabon, then please don't tell me about it.
So here's the thing, like, when people say something, I don't want them to like build up the hype for it. So my favorite thing is when I went out for breakfast with my mom, she took me, I think it was Miss Shirley's Cafe, and they have good French toast. And she said the French toast tastes just like a Cinnabon. And I went to Miss Shirley's Cafe. The French toast is fine, but it doesn't compare to a Cinnabon. You can't build something up in my mind like that. It's like, I don't know if you've seen the Avatar movie with the blue people. Everybody was like, it's the best movie ever. It's the greatest thing. And I saw it and I'm like, it's basically just Pocahontas.
Oh my goodness.
So like, it wasn't a bad movie because it was built up so high. It just, there was no way it could live up to the expectations. And
wow. Cinnabon
is just up here in my mind that you just should not compare anything to it.
Oh my goodness. All right. Well, last question about Cinnabon. When did this infatuation and love for it start?
So it started when I was about 3 or 4.
Hmm.
So when my grandma and my grandpa were teaching me how to walk, and like they would take me to the mall.
Mm-hmm.
And like, if I went and to the mall and I behaved myself, they would say, do you want a Cinnabon or a pretzel? And for whatever reason, I always picked the pretzel. And then one day I picked a Cinnabon. So the rest is kind of history. And like another fun fact, I've never actually like shared a Cinnabon with somebody, as in I've never like cut one in half and said, you have this half, I'll have that half. It's mine and no one else's. I will give you a Cinnabon, but if you try to cut a piece of my Cinnabon, I will cut a piece of you.
Troy, I am cracking up over here. Are you serious?
There may have been an incident where someone was cut of a plastic before, and I'm not even joking.
That person's name does not start with a J and last name B, right?
No.
Okay.
No.
All right. So that's a whole, that could be a whole episode right there. Cinnabons.
I mean, honestly, I've done a 25-minute lecture on Cinnabons before because I once got into an argument with a person in college because they had a Cinnabon at the mall, but like one night the Cinnabon was closed or whatever. And then they're like, oh, just go to the cafe, you can get a cinnamon roll. And I was like, excuse me?
No comparison.
No, none whatsoever.
Okay. Wow. All right. So our conversation is going to be about this 75 hard challenge that you participated in. When I first saw that you were doing it, I was like, oh my goodness, that 75 days is a long time. And I've done a challenge where I ate clean for 90 days, but my birthday fell within those 90 days. So, you know, I slipped up a little bit, right? So when I saw that you were doing this for 75 days, I automatically thought like, this is going to be hard, but I like knew you could do it, right? So were you able to follow it for 75 days straight?
Yes.
Wow. Okay. So how did you hear about the challenge? Like, did you create it or are you a part of a group or something?
Basically, what happened was when COVID started and like once schools closed and whatnot, I like was kind of in a bad routine as far as fitness goes because gyms were closed and I was spending so much time in the house. Like I was noticing I was only getting like 3,000 steps a day and I was barely running at that. So then I bought this fitness guide online from Claire P. Thomas. And then one of the links in her fitness guide links to an online fitness group. And this group is like so inspiring. There are people losing hundreds of pounds and it's basically all about lifting each other up. It's like the most positive fitness group I've ever been a part of. There's absolutely zero toxicity that I've seen so far. And a couple of people in the group were talking about this 75 hard challenge. And I was looking at it, I was like, this is actually pretty challenging because one of the things that happened to me during like the whole fitness and trying to get back in shape was there were two nights when friends were like, hey, Troy, let's hang out. And we had some alcohol. And then like the next day, I just did not feel like working out. I felt like I lost like 3 steps.
Wow.
So basically I said, you know what? I'm going to commit to doing this. So for 75 days, I had no alcohol, no Cinnabons. I had to work out twice a day. I had to read 10 pages of nonfiction, which is hard for me because I read a lot of fiction. I had a progress picture of myself so that I could see the progress I was making each individual day. And I feel like I am forgetting something. Oh, over a gallon of water.
That's a lot. So, and that's the thing, when I saw the challenge, it was like, it's not just following a diet, a specific diet. It's so much more to that. And I was like, that's a lot. That takes a lot of courage and determination, you know, just to do that. And when I do a challenge, it's normally because I ate like crap for like 3 weeks prior, you know, some event is coming up and I need to lose weight. But it seems like with this challenge, weight loss wasn't the center focus.
So it's actually kind of the opposite. So like, you probably can't tell, because like, my body does not really put on muscle that well, but I've actually gained about 15 pounds.
Wow.
So it's mostly muscle. And like, but the beginning of the challenge, I had like 185 pounds and I had a little bit of a belly that was hanging over my waist. And for me, that was just like, back in high school, I had like a 300 level six pack.
Wow. And
now it was just kind of like, I have a keg, which to me was like unacceptable.
Right. Okay. Wow.
And honestly, like, the main thing was it gave me something to focus on, because like, in high school and college, I was a track athlete, and being like a track athlete, you always have very specific goals. I want to hit this time or this distance in that event. I want to be able to do so-and-so by this date. But like, with after college, it's like, what do I focus my fitness goal for? Do I want to say like, I want to be this weight? Do I want to say I want to be able to lift this, and so on and so forth? So doing this challenge, it gave me something to focus on and put my energy into.
Wow. So it wasn't just on a specific number. It was also other goals that you were trying to achieve as well.
Yes.
Yeah. And
just kind of like mental wellness.
Because
I feel like if you go for so long without exercising, especially now when you can't really see but too many friends, when you can't really go outside, things can get very depressing. And I didn't want to feel that way. I feel like very positive and balanced. And
Yeah, that's awesome. I love that feeling. Like, when I meditate, that does that for me. But I can only imagine like, cleaning up your eating and working out, that also helps mentally as well. So what diet did you choose for yourself to follow for these 75 days, and workouts? Did you switch it up, or?
So the diet, like, I wasn't too strict with myself with that, because honestly, with the amount that I was working out and some of the workouts I was doing, so a couple of times I actually ran twice a day. And because of that, that imposes so many caloric needs on your body.
Right.
That's absolutely ridiculous. So basically, I just tried not, well, the no Cinnabons and no alcohol, obviously, but then basically just not anything too terrible. So I'm not really a dessert eater at all. That's a completely different story, that I've never had like a piece of cake. I've never had ice cream. I've never even had a piece of candy in my entire life.
Troy, okay, I think I need to stop. I need to know. What? Hold up. This is going in a different direction. What do you mean you've never had candy or cake or ice cream?
So first of all, I'm lactose intolerant.
Okay.
Second of all, so when I went for my dentist appointment when I was like very young, I go in and the office is empty besides myself and my parents and like the people that work there. And the dentist like pulls me in the chair. He like turns off the other lights. He puts a spotlight on above me. He has the mask on, pulls out the drill. And he's like, have you been eating candy and sweets? Because if you do, bad things will happen to you. So like, I was basically intimidated into not eating sweets. But like, it wasn't that traumatic. But at the same time, it's like, after a certain point, when you said, I haven't had these things, it's almost like, you know, this is a badge. Like, you're playing two truths and a lie. This is the one no one ever guesses.
Oh my goodness. I cannot. And you're not tempted. No one can tempt you with a cookie. What, you've had cookies?
No.
No one. Wait, what?
Oh. So here's the thing. If we're running down my list of desserts that I eat, so it is Cinnabons, plain glazed donuts. Because like, I honestly don't really like sweet things that much anyway. So Cinnabons, plain glazed donuts, pumpkin pie, sweet potato pie, and that's honestly about it.
Wow. That, do you, okay. Wow. I'm like in shock, because I wish I could say that. I wish, you know, at that young age, I had that experience with a dentist. And I think a lot of kids hear the dentist say that, but they never take them that seriously.
Yeah, I'm just a very odd person in that way. I took my doctor seriously and cared what they said.
Oh my goodness. Wow. All right, back to this challenge. Sheesh. Okay. What was the hardest thing for you to follow?
So that would actually change week by week. So working out twice a day, like I had to be very strategic in what I did as far as working out, because your body has a certain limit. And like, it's nice to say, I'm going to push through these limits, but I'm the kind of person who I have like pulled or torn my hamstrings between the two of them about 10 different times. Mm. So like, there's a lot of scar tissue down there.
Wow.
And I don't want to be injured again. So I had to think, okay, this is going to be a hard workout. And the next two workouts are going to be recovery workouts, because you can't like go hard 100% of the time. It just does not work, because at some point you're going to run into a wall and you're going to run into that wall hard. So one of the things that I would do is like, maybe I would run in the morning and then I would do a body weight workout in the afternoon. I did a lot of yoga. I did some intense stretching exercises. So also on Fridays, I was doing some volunteer work where I was like moving a lot of boxes and donating food and helping to distribute food at the food network. So that also counted as a workout. Just a lot of different things to switch it up, because normally when gyms are open and gyms are safe, I would maybe be on the elliptical, I'd be on the bike. But that wasn't really an option, because I went to the gym a couple of times. And my thing is, I was already a little bit of a neat freak. But now with like people not being conscious of COVID, I went to the gym once at midnight and I see 10 different people. They're not wearing masks. They're not wiping down equipment. And I'm like, nope. So when I did go to the gym, I had a very strategic plan. I'm going to go at 3-4 in the morning, right after they just finished cleaning. It'll be me and 5 other people max. And then I'll have mask, I'll have the gloves on, and I'll also have my lifting gloves. And that way I'm still staying safe.
3 and 4 in the morning.
So I will say that like, I was already doing this to an extent before COVID.
Are you serious?
Yeah. So like, my thing is, between teaching and coaching, my day typically doesn't end until like 5-6 o'clock. And if there's a track meet, I'm not getting home until 9:30, 10 o'clock. So if I don't get the workout in before work, I don't get my workout in. And I have very mixed feelings about working out with kids, because if I'm working out with them, I'm not able to observe them. And it also creates a sense of competition between me and the kids. And that's not healthy for anybody.
Mm-hmm. So when you're doing 3 and 4 in the morning gym visits, what time do you tend to go to sleep? Are you getting enough sleep within all of this?
So if I'm going to the gym at 3 and 4 in the morning, so like during the school year, I'll only do that like 3 times a week. And then I'll go to bed around 7:30, 8 o'clock.
Man, that's serious.
But also the nice thing is, like, during the summertime, it's not really an issue, because I'm a teacher and I don't have a summer job. So naps are my best friend. Like, I was napping like a kindergartner throughout this challenge, because that was one of the big things that helped me to recover from all the working out.
Oh, okay. Okay. Between you not eating ice cream and sweets and waking up at 3 and 4 in the morning, I just got to take it all in, Troy. So forgive me. Okay. So what was the biggest result, or what was your biggest takeaway from the challenge?
So first of all, like, I rediscovered my love of reading. So one of the things that was hard for me was, at one point I realized I actually need to buy more books, because I'm running out of nonfiction stuff at the house that I have not read. I didn't want to like reread something, because I wanted to like actually make this a journey of reflection and self-discovery. So I found this cool website called bookshop.org, where when you place an order with them, it actually places an order with like a local bookshop somewhere around the country. So it supports the small bookshops. So one of the other things is, since I stopped drinking, I had a lot more money. Ooh. So yeah. And the funny thing is, I spent most of it donating to charities. And then I actually spent probably $600 in the last 2 months on books.
Wow. All in all, throughout the challenge, how many books did you read? It was 10 pages a day.
So, yes. So 10 pages a day for 75 days, that would be 750. But my problem is like, if I'm really into a book, I can't just do 10 pages a day. Now, there are a bunch of days where it's like, oh my gosh, it's 11:30 and I haven't done my reading yet. And I'm trying to stay awake to do those 10 pages. But then there are other days where it's like, I'm really into this book. So I'm going to read 50 pages or 100 pages. So there was one book, I actually knocked it out in 2 days. And I was like, oh, I did not want this to happen because now I have to do another book. So I think I've read 7 books.
Wow. 7 books in 75 days. That's awesome. Which book was it that you knocked out in 2 days?
So it was this book called Citizen by Claudia Rankine.
Okay.
So it's basically a collection of like short stories and essays about race and various microaggressions and social commentary.
So which book out of the 7 would be, tell me your best and tell me your worst?
Ooh. So luckily I have my books right here. So
nice.
So the worst book by far was by J.K. Rowling. It was called Very Good Lives. Now, this was a book that I bought years and years ago because it was like on the 50 cent or whatever shelf. And it's basically just a graduation speech.
What?
And I did not read the print on it and see that it was a graduation speech. But you know what? The book has like larger print. So 10 pages, if I was like falling asleep and struggling, this was my go-to. That was my savior. But my favorite book by far was Why I'm No Longer Talking to White People About Race.
Wow. Okay. So tell me about that one. I haven't read it yet.
So I would highly recommend it. I would allow you to borrow my copy, but I have some very personal annotations in it that
you don't want us privy to that, huh?
No, I don't, because
like, okay,
it would be a very sensitive issue, and that actually did come up a couple of times during the challenge, which made some things very difficult. But basically, so the book, it goes about talking about race from various aspects. But the thing that I like about it is it doesn't talk about it from an American perspective, because I think that a lot of times when we think about race, we think about it as just an American problem, but it's a global problem. So the woman who wrote the book is actually British, and she talks about her problems in London and various issues. So she'll tackle it from a feminist perspective. She'll tackle it from, okay, we're not talking about crime. These laws are countering certain people and they don't allow certain people rights. And then there was this one quote, which I'm paraphrasing here, but it stuck with me so much. So she begins the chapter and she's talking about representation, and she's having a conversation with her mother, and she asks her mother when she's a small child, "Mom, when am I going to turn white?" Her mom is very confused, and her reason for asking that question was because whenever she watches TV shows or movies, all of the good people are white and all the criminals are black. And then I started to think to myself, it's like, okay, when I was a child growing up, like, who was like my favorite black character? And then I'm thinking about it, and like, things are weird for me because, one, I'm African American, and two, like, I haven't had hair since I was in 7th grade. So seeing a black bald character that's like a hero, that's very irregular, because they love to make their villains bald or have facial deformities and whatnot. And the closest thing I could think of was Little Bill.
Oh my.
Little Bill is not a hero.
No, he's not. He's cute, but.
No. Yeah.
Okay. So that was the best one that you read out of the 7.
And it allowed for a lot of reflection, and it honestly exposed a lot of biases in myself. So I was really open to that change. And the fact that like this book was so great, I just would recommend it to anyone, whether you're black or you're white. The title might seem intimidating, but hey.
Suck it up. It's always good when you read a book and it allows you to look deeper into yourself and just look at what you can change and obviously learn from the book as well. What did you think about You Are a Badass? I saw that was one of your reads.
So I like that one a lot, and it helped me to like kind of think about certain habits that I have with friendships, with relationships, and so on and so forth. And then I also used a lot of that stuff to build things for some of the kids in my classroom. So just like that title was an awesome title, and yeah. I had started it a while ago, but I had 50 pages left to finish, and I was like, you know what? Here's five more nights of reading right here.
Awesome. I actually listened to that as an audiobook. Are you a snuff about audiobooks and regular books? Okay, so you judge me real quick, huh?
So here's my thing about audiobooks, and I totally understand it. We live in a busy world. It's a lot easier to access an audiobook. You can't read while you're driving unless you're in a carpool and someone else is doing the driving. But like my thing is, I'm an English teacher. When I read a book, I mark it up. So I highlight it, I'll make margins, and I'll just like talk about my reactions. So one of like my favorite things to talk about is like for years I taught ninth grade English. When I was in high school, we had to actually purchase the books that we read in class. So I still have my ninth grade copy of To Kill a Mockingbird, my original notes from when I was in ninth grade. And each time I reread it, I make new notes. But when I reread over my notes from when I was in ninth grade, it's almost like I'm having a conversation with my past self.
That's awesome.
Which you can't do with an audiobook.
You can't do that. You're absolutely right. And sometimes I do feel like I'm cheating when I listen to an audiobook. But when I'm driving home, like you said, it's necessary. Sometimes just got to do it, Troy. Just, all right, don't be judging me, man. Now, I also saw that you read Ta-Nehisi Coates. Which one was that one?
Between the World and Me.
How was that? Because I have his Water Dancer, and I've had that book for more than a year, and I'm still on page 7. So it was, it's hard for me to get into. I mean, it's fiction. So it's different from his regular writing. But what do you think of him as an author? And was that book good? How would you rate it?
So I love his stuff, although I typically only read his nonfiction as well as, so he actually wrote some issues of Black Panther, which that was really good. And then he has a lot of commentary pieces that are online. But I love this book. So the whole thing is it's framed as a conversation with his son about his experience with race and racism throughout his life. And it's a very real conversation, which I think a lot of people are afraid to have. And the thing is, it's not really censored. It's just like, this is how I feel. And like, I feel as if as being a teacher, sometimes you have to kind of embrace that with your students because they have legitimate questions. And the world is very dangerous, whether you are a person of color or not, just because there is so much going on and there is so much hate in the world. We need to be able to embrace each other's differences, but we also need to be able to discuss what the problems with today's society are, which is why I love this book so much. And the thing is, I actually have read this book before, so it's a funny story. I actually read it at a bachelor party because I was the first person to wake up and it's on the person's shelf and no one else woke up for 4 hours. So I'm like, you know what? It's 230 pages. I can knock this out. And I did. But the thing is, because I read someone else's copy, I couldn't mark it up. So it was driving me crazy. So wow. I bought my own version. So then I could actually have that experience.
I picked up that book. I read like a couple pages, but I'm back in school as well. And it's like I had books for school to read, and then this book that I wanted to read, his book that I wanted to read on my own. And it was a lot. Like, you didn't feel like it was deep, or, I mean, maybe your brain is more clear than mine, but I had like so much going on, and I'd like opened the book and I was like, I can't read this right now. It was a lot.
So here is my thing. So like during the challenge, I had like an experience with some potential racism that scared the crap out of me. And half of the books that I purchased were actually dealing with race and race relations. And the thing is, sometimes you kind of need a mental break because that is such a deep subject and there is so much to unpack. Mm-hmm. Sometimes people need that fiction, but unfortunately, fiction wasn't really an option because I had to read the 10 pages of nonfiction. So that those were the days where I switched to like more of like the self-help and self-reflection books, just because reading about race every single day while people of color are being murdered, while there's protests are going on, while people are saying Black lives don't matter, it's a very difficult thing because sometimes we do need a distraction.
Absolutely. Now, you said you experienced some bouts of racism. So that was recently?
Yes.
Wow. Would you go into it or you don't feel like talking about that?
No, I can go into it.
Okay.
So one of them was an issue of perception. So it was during a track workout. I was on the track, and because I'm a track coach, I know where all the tracks are in the county. I know which ones are less likely to be overpopulated, because the track where we work, there's always 55 people.
Mm-hmm.
And with COVID, I didn't want that many people on the track while I'm trying to work out, because I'm trying to maintain distance. So I go to a school, and when I go there, there's only 10 other people on the track. So I start working out, and then I started working out probably around 7:30. And then as the workout progresses, I notice people are leaving, it's starting to get dark. And, you know, I'm going really hard. And the thing is, when I'm on the track, I'm right now the fastest person. So I'm going in the outside lanes, but I'm also very conscious of how like frightening it can be when you pass a person, you suddenly hear this huffing and puffing and you're not expecting that. So I made sure I was like three lanes away whenever I did that, because I don't want to scare anybody. And at the towards the end of the workout, I noticed it's just myself and an older white woman. And as I finish my last set, I'm hunched over. I'm like gasping for air because like I'm tired. I just ran a 200 all out and I've been working out for about an hour. And then she approaches me and she says, "Are you done? I'm feeling uncomfortable." Now, when she says that, my mind thinks like five different things. I'm thinking that, okay, I need to leave this track right now because this could be it. I'm making her feel uncomfortable because it's a racial thing, it's a sexual thing, I don't know what the deal is. And her tone was also not the friendliest. And that could have just been the fact that like my ears are ringing, I'm working out, I can't breathe. And then I get up and I kind of give her a look like, "Are you serious?" And she kind of switches up and she says, "Oh, I actually meant like, I'm feeling uncomfortable. Could you stay longer? Because I don't want to be the last person here."
Wow.
So like, yeah. Honestly, like she wasn't being racist, but like her words were so poor when she initially said them. And like for her, she probably doesn't even remember that interaction to this day. But for me, that's going to stick with me because I will always think that could be me on the news. And I feel like sometimes the issue is, obviously, racism is a thing that you can see it, you can observe it, you can talk about it, but unless you have fully experienced it, it's really hard to understand how deep and how hurtful of an issue it is. And like my thing is, I've had racism and I've also had prejudice from people that are both Black, and I've also had it from people that are white. I mean, I'll never forget my first day of college. There were two people on the basketball team. Now, I went to Goucher, which is not the most like African-American predominant school. And there's like a meeting for athletes and there are two gentlemen and they're like, "What position do you play?" And I look at them, I say, "I play runner." And they're like, "Runner is not a position." And I'm like, "You're right. I don't play basketball. I'm tall, I'm Black, but I run track. And as a matter of fact, I run distance," which doesn't always go together. So,
life, man, it's hard.
Who are you telling me?
All right. So, all in all, you completed the challenge. You learned a lot. It sounds like you learned a lot. You did some self-reflecting and do you feel like a better person at the end? Was it worth it?
I mean, so I guess I feel like a better person. I feel more enlightened, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. So I've even kept up with some of the stuff, not all the stuff, since the challenge is in. So today would actually be my 90th day without alcohol. I'm still drinking over a gallon of water every day. I'm not working out twice a day because honestly, after the challenge, I had to take 2 days where I'm just like, you know what? I am going to be lazy. I'm still reading 10 pages because I want to do that kind of self-reflection. I also just want to obtain more knowledge. But yeah, it's changing, and that's what the whole purpose of it is. To create this ability to self-reflect and to kind of put you in a more positive mindset. So it worked.
Nice. Now, was there ever a time that you wanted to quit?
So I will say that honestly, the hardest day was day 74, which like makes no sense because it's like, you're right there, you're right at the finish. But the thing was, day 74 was the first day of school. So I had to adapt to this new schedule. And normally, like, I could do a workout at any given point in the day. I could wake up at 4, I could do it at 8, I could do it at 10, I could do it at 1. And I didn't do my first workout that day until 3 p.m. Mm. So me waiting that long to try to get it done, and I was like, you know what? I could just say I did 74 days. I could stop right now and I wouldn't have to post this on Facebook or anything. I could just say, hey, Kay, I've changed, but like I failed at this. But at the same time, it was just like, you know what? I've gone this far. I'm going to figure out a way to squeeze it in. I got the gallon of water in. I did a nice run. I did some body weight stuff. I may have stayed up a little bit later than I wanted to, but It happened.
Awesome. Well, congratulations, Troy. I wish I had like a prize to give you or something, but it seems like what you gain from doing the challenge is priceless.
Thank you.
Yes, you're welcome. Now, you are a man who wears many hats. You are known as, I'm bringing it up, Chef Troy RD, right? Now, you're a superhero comic book buff, right? Is that the proper term? Is that politically correct? Is there an actual word for it?
I mean, yes, it is politically correct. I mean, term nerd is very pejorative, and Big Bang Theory ruined it for a lot of people in my community. Most of us hate that show, but yeah, that's the complete.
Okay. And you tend to scrapbook from time to time, right?
Yes.
Okay, cool. But the hat that I want to talk about right now is your educator hat.
So this is currently my 7th year of teaching.
Okay. Awesome. Now, I've never worked directly in your classroom, but I noticed that to some of your students, they've dubbed you as the English teacher that changed their life.
Yeah, that has happened. I actually cried earlier this week because a student wrote me this really touching letter about how I taught her English, but more importantly, I made her a better person, which...
Wow, that, Troy, that is amazing. I think I see some tears, guys. But, you know, that is something that you should really be proud of. So what is it about you? What is it about your teaching style? Or, you know, what happens in that classroom? You know, what happens in 235 or whatever, 239, sorry. What happens in there?
So that's kind of hard to sum up in a sentence, because if you were to ask various students from various years about like what moment stuck with them the most, it would probably come up with 20 different answers. The key thing that I like to think about is each of one of my students is a person, and each person that enters my classroom, I try to build a relationship. So usually like on the first day of class, what I will do is I'll ask students to write down 10 things that they like. And I'll say, don't write sleep, don't write food, don't write money. But it always happens inevitably. And what I do is whenever I build a lesson, I try to find an engaging video clip that somehow relates to what the kids like. And like in my 7 years, there's only ever been one student who I did not get a single thing on his list because he only put one thing. It was motocross. But like, for example, so like 2 years ago now, I taught a lesson about character foil, and a lot of my kids love Disney. So instead of using like Oedipus and somebody else or some kind of literary character, I pulled a clip from Frozen. So we watched for the first time in forever and analyzed why Anna and Elsa are foils. Mm. And the kids are singing. Some people are dancing. I'm getting observed.
Oh my goodness.
It was a very unique experience. But the thing is, I want students to feel that their likes are embraced. I want them to feel at home in my classroom. So I might not have a million things in common with every student. That's happened a couple of times. But if I can build that one commonality, if I can make that kid smile on that one lesson where it's like, oh my gosh, you know, Mr. Browne, like he loves Spider-Man, but he doesn't like blah, 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 blah. I don't think I'm ever going to see a clip. That one time there's that one clip that relates to them. That's the thing that really gets me. That plus the fact that like I always make a point to try to have big discussions because I want them to be able to voice their opinions because English isn't just about writing, it's about the perspective.
Wow. That's pretty cool. That I can understand how kids can appreciate that because like you said, it's just making them feel important and you know, what you like is important as well. So
yeah. And honestly, so every year that I've been teaching, except for this year, and if we end up going back, it'll be the first thing that goes up. But I have this Spider-Man poster and it's the very basic, with great power comes great responsibility. And that is why I teach. Because being a teacher, you have the power to build relationships, to shape minds. And that is a huge responsibility and you need to take that seriously. And every time a student enters my classroom, I think about what kind of impact I'm going to have on them. And a couple of years ago, that whole thing about who was your first like Black teacher, who was your first male Black teacher came up. And for a lot of my students, I was their first teacher. And the thing that's scary to me about that, I have mostly only taught 9th and 10th grade for my entire career. So to think that you're going most of your adult life without having a teacher of color, that can be very scary.
It is. And, you know, I remember having female teachers who are Black, but a male Black teacher is very rare.
Well, like, I think male Black teachers in English, period, are kind of like performance, because I never had a male English teacher in middle school or high school. All of my male Black teachers were social studies or science.
Wow. So as far as you, like when you were in high school or middle school, elementary school, did you have what? I'm not going to say nothing crazy.
Well, no, it's just like I'm already prepared because I have two stories that I feel like are probably going to come up, but go ahead and ask your question.
We'll see. Okay. So, but did you have that special teacher that did things that made you feel like, you know, when I grow up, I want to be a teacher and this is the type of teacher I want to be because of this teacher?
So here's the thing. I had a favorite teacher of all time, which that he threw out the window once he did one thing in my class that was very racist. And then I also had a least favorite teacher of all time. When that thing happened, I said, I never want to be like this woman. Mm. So the whole thing with my former favorite teacher was, so he liked to showcase certain students. And at one point we ran out of like individual desks. So he got a table put in the front of his room and he said, this is going to be the nerd table. All of my smartest students will sit at this table. So I get sat at the table, which, you know, like for a put on showcase, he's saying I'm smart, which is nice, but also being called a nerd, whatever. But he has the personality that's kind of similar to mine. He's very sarcastic and he likes a lot of random things. But then one day, so he's a world history teacher. So he's teaching a lesson about slavery and he's also a white teacher. And then he says, hey, Troy, can you stand up? And then he says, hey, Adebayo, can you also stand up? And then he performs an social experiment and he says, all right, guys, we're going to pretend that you guys are slave masters. If you are picking one of these two, which one are you going to pick? So Adebayo is a lot larger than I am. I mean, he's not nearly as athletic, but like, we often base athleticism based on the size of one's muscles rather than other things. So he says, do you pick Adebayo or do you pick Browne? And everybody's like, oh, we're picking Adebayo. And he's like, you're right, because he's skinny. You don't want to pick him as a slave. And I'm like, okay, so now I'm getting body shamed. I can be picked as a slave. And do I want to be picked as a slave? And then one of my friends, he stands up for me in class. He's like, I'm not going to pick Troy because you know what? He's the captain of the cross country team. If I pick him, he's going to run to freedom and then we will never see him again.
Wow. Way to spin it around.
But yeah, that was very awkward to happen in class.
I can only imagine. And I heard, because sometimes it's so weird, and it might be weird for white teachers as well, but sometimes you just have to do some research before, because that's an awkward situation to put you in. And sometimes my kids or a friend of mine, her daughter, they were having a slavery discussion in high school, and the teacher is like, well, what do you think? Why don't ask me because I'm Black? Like, don't put me on the spot. I can't speak for everyone, you know? And I hate when that happens. That's hard to, okay, I can understand why he's no longer your favorite.
I didn't even tell you about the trifling teacher. So this woman would show up to work on average 40 minutes late every day.
What?
Now, as a teacher, I always think of responsibility and supervision. So if I am going to be late, which has only happened once in 7 years, but like I was like 30 seconds late and it was fine. But this woman would show up 40 minutes late, but she would not call in for a substitute or call in for coverage. So we would be in that room unattended. Now, I will tell you, I left school multiple times. I went out, I drove, I got Bojangles for breakfast, came back, sat in the parking lot, ate my breakfast, and she still wasn't there.
Wow.
Now, one day she showed up on time. I was like 5 seconds late, and she says, you need to go to the office to get a pass. And I look at her like, who are you? And then I was just like, why do I need to do that? She's like, that's what happens when we're late. And I was like, how many passes do you have? And she's like, excuse me? And it's like, you know, if I go to the office and get a pass, I'm going to bring a vice principal up and I'm going to tell him about my experience in this class and how many times I have been here unattended without a teacher. And also the fact that multiple times when she was late, she texted people on their personal phones and told them to play games while they were waiting. Do you want me to get that pass? Because I will get that pass and I will bring that principal up here. And she's like, yeah, you can take a seat. And I'm like, you're goddamn right, I'm going to take a seat. And
that
wasn't even the worst thing. So she had this rule where we did not read the like prescribed literature for the class. So we weren't reading Shakespeare. We weren't reading any of that stuff. We were reading books published by her friends. Because like I said, we had to purchase the books that we were reading. So there was this one book called Born in the Streets, but Raised in Prison.
Oh.
And here's the thing. It's not like a terrible book, but it should not have been read in school. And the thing is, I was a very intelligent student at the time. I was reading ahead of everybody. And she did not read the book before she assigned it to us. That is like the golden rule. If you're going to be a teacher, you need to read the material so you can engage it with your students. Also, so you know what should not be read. So I'm reading one day in class, and I'll never forget it. It was chapter 12. I'm reading it, and all of a sudden, my face turns red, my eyes go wide, and I run up to her and I was like, hey, I know that we have had issues in the past, but between you and me, and this isn't going to go public, which now it has, have you read this book? And she's like, yes, baby, I have. And I was like, excuse me, first of all, don't call me baby. My name is Troy. But honestly, did you read this book? And she's like, yes. So I show her the book in this chapter. So the book has like gangbangers and like some of them have gone to jail, blah, 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 blah. In this book, this 12-year-old just got out of juvie and his 40-year-old uncle throws him a party. And you know what? They're gangbangers. So they're going to have a party. They're getting lit. So there's alcohol, there's drugs, there's prostitutes. And
what?
Going into detail about what they are doing with those prostitutes. So to this day, I will never forget this line. I never knew a woman's was so versatile.
And you learned that in 11th grade English.
11th grade English. They had whips, they had ice, they were shooting things like cannons. And I'm just like, they're having a freaking orgy in this book and I'm reading this in an 11th grade English classroom.
First of all, where did you go to school? Don't say Maryland, because I'm not going to believe it.
PG County, baby.
What? Wait, there's a Bojangles in PG County?
Yes, there's a Bojangles in PG County. Why wouldn't there be?
I thought that was like down south or something.
Have you been to PG County?
Maybe, maybe not. I don't know.
DC County is, you know, Southern.
Oh, okay. I'm from the Bronx, you know. I don't know about all that. Now, like I said, you wear many hats, and I forgot to mention, well, this might be a mask. Spider-Man. is he your favorite superhero?
Yes. So if you ask anyone that knows me, they would say, all right, Troy likes Cinnabons and Spider-Man. Those are like his two favorite things.
Wow.
So Spider-Man is my favorite.
Okay. And have you always been into comics?
Here's the thing. Like when I was younger, they had the animated television show. So there was like Spider-Man, the animated series, Batman, the animated series, and X-Men, the animated series. And I just love the Spider-Man television show. And then I love the like Tobey Maguire Spider-Man movies. He's my number one Spider-Man, and we can fight about that, whatever. But I honestly did not own a comic book until 2002, 2003, when my mom bought me one for my birthday. And ironically, it was a Flash comic book because that was my nickname back in high school when I did track.
Okay. So you were pretty fast.
I mean, fast is a subjective term, but like I was decent. I've never won an individual state championship. I've never won an individual conference championship, but I went to states all but one season when I was in high school. And then I did help my team win a conference title for a relay. So
nice. What's your fastest mile?
My fastest mile would be about 4:38.
Oh my goodness. What?
Well, keep in mind that, like, I have friends that have gone professional, that have gone to, like, the Olympic trials. So, like, for some people, that's impressive. But, like, 4:38 doesn't even win, like, a state championship. And the mile wasn't even my best event. So.
Wow. I think my fastest, if I look back, could be, like, a 9:08 or something. But that was, like, a couple years ago. And now I'm just... I wish I can get back there. I'm trying, but I got to get my life together. I got to do a challenge, Troy.
I mean, if you want, remember, I do coach track, so I'm happy to provide some tips.
All right. I need to take you up on that because I'm like, I want to get back to 9-10 minutes. I'm like 11:30 now, and it's like, I want to get back. I look through my Nike app and look, you know, look at those paces from years ago. And it's like, wait, is my age like really catching up on me? Or am I just getting lazy? I don't know. I got to figure that out. But so were you into Black Panther as well?
So Black Panther. So here's the funny thing. Most people, when we talk about like the Marvel movies, like the like recent ones, they always say like, oh my gosh, Troy must have been crying when he saw Spider-Man die. But like when like the Infinity War, when Black Panther died, that was the thing that moved me, because I'm thinking about like comic book movies and I'm thinking about Black characters. Mm-hmm. And for the most part, they have always been sidekicks. They have been criminals. But then there's this movie where you have a Black man in an almost entirely Black cast, and he's wearing the suit and he's bulletproof. And I remember I had so many discussions in my classroom about that, because they're like, you know, this is the first time I can see myself in this hero, and he's cool. He's not like this lame guy who has these two powers that only shows up for jokes or something like that. He has this demeanor. He doesn't make these like silly jokes. He is taken seriously. And then he's also kicking butt and looking cool while doing it.
Mm.
And it was so powerful to me and so powerful to my students, because I'm thinking about Black superheroes on the big screen, and you have Shaq Steel, which let's not talk about that. You have Wesley Snipes as a Blade, which like it wasn't the worst, but it also wasn't the best. No one that I've ever talked to has said Blade was the best superhero movie ever. But then you have Black Panther, and it's so good too. I mean, there are some flaws with it, but it is a great movie and it has so much representation. And the fact that like they are actually digging into the culture, it's not just a showpiece like, okay, we need to put the Black person here just so that we can say that we are diverse. It's not like that.
It was like full-fledged Wakanda Forever, you know, this is us. Yeah, I can understand that as well, because when I took my children to see it, you know, hearing my daughter say, oh, I can be his sister, or, you know, things like that, like you said, representation really matters. And to hear the passing of Chadwick was pretty hard. And it's like, he's two people to us. He's Black Panther, and then he's Chadwick Boseman. So with that, were you more saddened by the death of Black Panther or Chadwick?
So that's kind of hard to separate, because I think about Chadwick and the number of roles that he did and the number of like key Black historical people that he played. I'm looking at his filmography and I'm just like, how did he do this in this many years? And hiding cancer while he was doing that? But then also I think about how many people were first exposed to him because of the Black Panther. How many people are like, this is my superhero. This is the person I look up to. This is the person when I watch these Marvel movies, I can actually relate to, that I see myself in, that now they potentially no longer have that, depending on what direction they go in. I mean, I think I would be more upset personally with the loss of Chadwick, but like for my students and for many of my friends, I would be more upset at the loss of Black Panther.
Wow. Wow. And what is, before we go, what is the one thing that you'll remember the most about Chadwick or Black Panther? Something that will always stick with you?
So there is this random clip, and I haven't seen all of his movies, and they ask him to sing. And, you know, with biopics, you never know sometimes who's doing the singing, like Ray Charles, the movie. So Jamie Foxx is doing some of the singing, but then some of it is actually Ray. But then, like, they ask Chadwick, he's like, hey, can you sing us something? And he starts singing, and I'm just like, what couldn't this man do?
So he could sing too.
Yeah, and I was just taken aback by that. I mean, a lot of people point at the clip with him and Jimmy Fallon when people are talking about the impact Black Panther had on him. But that was the first time I heard him sing. And to know that he had such a voice, and I did not know that about him. Because being a singer, being an actor, and then also he had very good comedic skills too. It's like, this guy had so much talent at such a young age. I just can't remember someone having this amount of impact in such a little bit of time. It almost makes me feel like I need to be doing more, like I'm behind in my life. I'm like, wow, okay, I'm 28 now. I'm starting to get up there. What have I done, really?
You are starting to get up there, whatever, Troy. I'm 28 plus what? Plus 11, okay? Get up there with me.
Not too quickly.
Right. But I think you're doing amazing, especially, you know, having the impact on your students that you have, because that's something that, you know, they'll remember forever, and they'll be able to influence others as well. So keep up the good work, Troy. And thank you so much for joining me today to have a conversation with me, a random nobody.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me.
Well, after this episode, I really only have one thing to say. PG County, I'm gonna need y'all to get y'all English teachers together, because that book should not have been in the hands of any 11th grade student. I mean, I'm not judging, but I'm just saying. Well, I hope you guys enjoyed my conversation with Troy, and he's actually going to come back on to discuss running, because as he said, he does coach track. So I'm going to have him back to, you know, give us some running tips, because a sister trying to get a little bit fit. You know what I'm saying? Well, I hope you guys enjoyed this episode, and as always, please follow me on social media. I'm Random Knowbody Podcast on Instagram, on Twitter. I don't really use Twitter, but you know, why not follow me? It's just, you just hit a button, you know, it doesn't cost you anything. Random Knowbody 1 on Twitter. You can email me at randomnobodypodcast@gmail.com, or you can check out my website at www.conversationswitharandomnobody.com. I ask that you, if you're not subscribed, that you please subscribe It matters. Yeah, so just hit that subscribe button on Apple, on Spotify, hit follow, and on Anchor, hit that star. Leave me a review, guys. Let me know what you think. And, you know, spread the word about my podcast. I've been, you know, telling people that I come into contact with at the store, my neighbors, anyone that you think might be interested. I just ask that you, you know, let them know about me. I appreciate you so much, and I'm looking forward to the next episode. So until next time, walk good. Translation, be safe. Started from the bottom, look where we end up, on top like pop. All eyes on us. My blessings. No more worries, no more stressing. No more stress. With every loss, there comes a lesson. Lord, all I'm asking is protection. Count my blessings. I wake up and count my blessings.